Philip Roth is one of America's leading novelists. In a career spanning 50 years, he has often been the subject of controversy, but above all, he has been acclaimed for the boldness of his stories and the richness of his writing. Much of Roth's work has come out of his Jewish-American upbringing in Newark, New Jersey, where he was born in 1933. With the publication of Portnoy's Complaint in 1969, Roth became a household name. An audacious novel that includes the masturbatory fantasies of a young Jewish boy, Portnoy's Complaint led to such a strange and noisy brand of American celebrity that its author moved out of the city and into the countryside. In over 20 novels, Roth has often called upon the services of three fictional writers to narrate his stories: Nathan Zuckerman, David Kepesh, and even a character called Philip Roth. All seem to share characteristics with the real Roth, but he has been famously and rightly guarded about where fact ends and fiction begins. In 1995, Sabbath Theater won a National Book Award and heralded a new phase in Roth's work. It was followed by three Zuckerman novels, forming what has become known as the American Trilogy. These books explore the impact of history on the individual: the Vietnam War in American Pastoral, McCarthyism in I Married a Communist, and the 1990s obsession with political correctness in The Human Stain. For many years, Roth has spent most of his time at his home in rural Connecticut. I met him there in the cabin where he writes on the eve of his 70th birthday to discuss his American trilogy. Philip, I want to start with a highbrow reference. Recently in Entertainment Weekly, Bruce Springsteen was interviewed. And when he was asked if he had a current cultural hero, someone whose work continues to evolve in a way that he'd like to see his own work evolve, he answered this: "I'll tell ya. Those three recent books by Philip Roth, American Pastoral, I Married a Communist, The Human Stain, just knocked me on my ass. To be in his 60s making work that is so strong and so full of revelations about love and emotional pain, that's the way to live your artistic life. Sustain, sustain, sustain." Mm-hmm. You heard about this. How did you feel?
You're not going to make a living, David, as doing your Bruce Springsteen imitation.
Well, I tried not to.
Yeah, of course I heard about it. He's a literate fellow. I'm not surprised that these books speak to him for regional reasons. Mm-hmm. We come from the same part of the world, which is industrial North Jersey. So I suppose that making use of local material and imbuing local material with your sense of things, my having done it, probably has some appeal to him.
Well, Philip, let's start out by talking about what Newark was and what is it's the kind of Arcadia for you, and it has always been in your books. That's where you're from.
Arcadia, no, but that's
but a very specific part of Newark. And talk a little bit, I think, to begin about what Newark was as opposed to New York City right across the river.
My orientation as a boy was by no means to New York City, nor did I know anybody in New York City. We had no, our family was spread out, but not, they weren't in New York. So there was no reason ever to go to New York. The only time I ever went to New York as a child was for some birthday celebration or for my parents' anniversary. And where did we go? We went to the Radio City Music Hall to see the Rockettes and went to Chinatown to sinfully eat Chinese food. That was the sinning part of our life. In addition, New York was a substantial city. A city of what, about 250,000 people? It was one of the 15 or so largest cities in America. It had a very vibrant life as an industrial working class city. So who needed New York?
And your family got there in the first place. You had Yiddish speaking grandparents, mm-hmm. and your father sold insurance. It was not a bookish house particularly, was it?
We had a book. There were about three books.
Yeah.
I remember them very vividly. I didn't go near them, but I remember they were there. There were books that were given as presents when someone was ill. You know? And I'm not saying that to burlesque it, that's a fact.
Right.
No, there were no books. But there were magazines and newspapers. So there wasn't an absence of reading.
Right.
But the reading was very much the reading of a working man, my father. So when you ask, were there books in the house, the answer is no. And I think it would be no for almost every kid I knew, which didn't mean that there wasn't reading going on in the house. And it certainly didn't mean that the highest value wasn't to read.
What was the style of your Newark when you were growing
up? As a kid?
When, yeah.
Well, fundamentally, we were good kids living in neighborhoods where we were encouraged to be good kids, who went to an excellent public school, the best perhaps probably in the state. It's between 1930, when the high school I went to was built, 32, and 1950 when I got out. More graduates became PhDs than any other high school in the state. These houses with no books were full of kids who read.
Mm-hmm. A high school reunion in Newark is the springboard for the story of Swede Lvov, the central character of 1997's American Pastoral. Its narrator, Nathan Zuckerman, remembers the Swede from their school days as a legendary athlete who seemed destined for a life of boundless American success. Though the Swede prospers both personally and professionally, embracing all that post-war America has to offer, his idyllic life is abruptly shattered when his daughter Mary, in protest against the Vietnam War, turns terrorist and bombs the local post office, killing a family acquaintance.
Before the trilogy began, before you started writing the trilogy, you wrote a novel called Sabbath Theater, which you've described as, in artistic terms, as the freest experience of your life. And then you come to American Pastoral and a trilogy of novels. What was the thinking that preceded American Pastoral?
In a way, you said it. The thinking, I mean this quite seriously, the thinking that preceded American Pastoral was Sabbath Theater. I was trying to create someone who is deep in the disorder, Mickey Sabbath, someone who's not fearful of the repellent, who says, I am repellent, I am disorder, you know. Someone who wants to be dead, but he can't die. He has the opportunity finally to kill himself. He says he can't leave. Everything he hated was here, you see. And the next book, whose hero is called Swede Lvov, says at one point, everything I love mm-hmm. is here. So the thinking that preceded it really was the springboard for me to have another man whose portrait I wanted to paint, really.
An ultimately responsible man, a decent man,
trying
to hold it
together.
Those
words describe him, yeah.
Right.
This man deeply engaged by the traditional facts of a middle-class life is swept away, as many people were swept away, by the events of what we now call the 60s. Essentially, it has to do with the Vietnam War. A man whose commitment is powerful to his parents, his wife, his daughter, his city, his business, his country, and appears to live outside of the great forces that you read about in the headlines every day. There's a man focused on his immediate world. And it turns out that because he's focused on his immediate world, he's history's hostage.
Who could have imagined that his life would come apart in this horrible way? A sliver off the comet of the American chaos had come loose and spun all the way out to old Remnick and him. His great looks, his larger-than-lifeness, his glory, our sense of his having been exempted from all self-doubt by his heroic role. That all these manly properties had precipitated a political murder made me think of the compelling story of Kennedy, John F. Kennedy. Only a decade the Swede's senior, and another privileged son of fortune, another man of glamour exuding American meaning, assassinated while still in his mid-40s, just 5 years before the Swede's daughter violently protested the Kennedy-Johnson War and blew up her father's life. I thought, but of course, he is our Kennedy.
It's a tragedy in which the object of the tragedy doesn't get what he deserves. He isn't destroyed because of some event that he sets into motion. He's a complete innocent in a way, isn't he? He is, he does everything he can to be decent to everyone he can. Mm. And in the end, life and history ruins him. It's kind of unusual in the history of tragedy and the way tragedy usually works.
Well, I don't know whether the issue of innocence is with all due respect, whether it's a significant issue in the book. It isn't a matter of what he deserves or doesn't deserve. Who deserves what?
But he has a daughter. He has a daughter named Mary. When Mary is young, mm-hmm. She says to him, "Kiss me like you kiss mommy." And in one moment, he kind of does, mm-hmm. and it tortures him for the rest of his mm-hmm. years, thinking that maybe that was the psychological event that threw the switch mm-hmm. that turned her into essentially a crazy, violent
terrorist
ideologue. And it probably isn't. Mm-hmm. In fact, he is a blameless man.
Blamelessness is not the issue. The important thing is to keep your eye on his attempt to find an explanation, even if it means blaming himself. Mm-hmm. Because an explanation will ease the suffering. Every explanation that he comes up with or that is offered to him by others is not congruent with the experience. So the suffering is therefore increased because the tragedy is senseless. There's a line in the narration which says he learned the most awful thing there is to learn, which is that his life made no sense.
Right. In American Pastoral, the key characters are heightened to an enormous degree. Swede Lvov is not just any businessman. He's enormously good-looking, a great athlete in high school. Mm-hmm. He's a kind of prototypical American star. His daughter is not merely a Vietnam protester. She is a freak, and she eventually becomes a Jane who wears a veil and fears that she might step on insects in her darkened room and is a lunatic. And Swede's wife is not merely pretty, she's Miss New Jersey. Mm-hmm. Why take all these characters and heighten them up almost to the edge of where they might be caricature if left at just the level of type?
Well, I don't agree with your placement of these people in the chain of human experience. You know, the vividness of the contrasts was the shock of the moment. Times aren't shocking if they're the finely modulated distinctions. You mm-hmm. know? Times are shocking when there's a great clash of things in a society. Life during the French Revolution was shocking. Do you know Chaffour, the great French epigrammist? Mm-hmm. He said during the Revolution, you'd have to eat a live toad for breakfast in order not to run into something more disgusting during the course of the day. Well, that's true of that decade I'm writing about, too. What was disgusting was extraordinarily disgusting. Whether, by the way, it was the lies of Lyndon Johnson or the behavior of a Mary Lvov. Mm-hmm. What was disgusting that was going on in Vietnam was incredibly disgusting because of the confusion about the cause, right? Not to mention the means being used. So you must remember that there's a correspondence, I hope, mm-hmm. between these heightened instances and what I'm writing about. Also, there's something else there, but there's the dare. Miss New Jersey. Why not? Why not? What do I know about Miss New Jersey? I don't know anything. So let's see if I can do it. Mm. If I accept the Miss New Jersey challenge as a writer, I'm in business. Mm. I've got my I got my work to do, you know? Mm. So that's the way I do it.
You wanted Miss America? Well, you've got her with a vengeance. She's your daughter. You wanted to be a real American jock, a real American Marine, a real American hotshot with a beautiful Gentile babe on your arm? You longed to belong like everybody else in the United States of America. Well, you do now, big boy, thanks to your daughter. The reality of this place is right up in your kisser now. With the help of your daughter, you're as deep in the shit as a man can get. The real American crazy shit. America amok. America amok.
Philip, in this book, in American Pastoral, there is a kind of double imagining. We're made very conscious of the fact that Zuckerman, our narrator, doesn't necessarily know the facts of Swede's life, mm-hmm. Swede's tragedy, but imagines it. Mm-hmm. Why that decision?
The problem for most seriously ambitious writers is, how do you drive the wedge of consciousness into the experience? How? Think of the ways people have done it. Think of Henry James here, and think of James Joyce here, and think of Ernest Hemingway here. If you try to hold the three of them in mind at the same time, you see that they make colossally different approaches to this same problem. But it's the problem of novel writing. It's what fiction seems to me to be about. And the great invention in fiction, why it's called fiction, it's not because it invents events. It's because it invents consciousness, which is an invention. So now we're back to my fabrication and my ventriloquism and my ventriloquist, who is Zuckerman. Mm-hmm. And so I begin with the matrix of consciousness that moral and social and whatever, that Zuckerman gives me.
You've darkened him, in a sense, for the project. Zuckerman has been a large presence in earlier novels. Zuckerman comes to this project without an erotic life. Mm-hmm. He's had a prostate, his prostate's removed, he's older.
Cancer, he said cancer. Yeah.
Why that? What does that give you?
I wanted him only to be, if not a consciousness, a recording device, a brain, eyes, ears, no genitals, right? That doesn't mean no genitals, no life. Consciousness is rich too. Mm-hmm. But he's no longer a player, and he's also removed himself from society. Don't forget, the more, even as important as the cancer and the lost experiences from the cancer, is that he no longer lives in the world.
Even in this darkest of novels, you find time to have a good time and to let us have a good time. And there's a scene in which we hear that Jerry, Swede's brother, when he was a kid, tried to make a coat out of mouse skins. Hamster skins.
If you don't know about furs, David, then don't ask the question. You don't live between a mouse and a hamster.
I don't wear fur.
Okay.
And you once remarked that sheer playfulness and deadly seriousness are my closest friends. What did you mean by that?
I think that's the formula to describe the concoction that energizes virtually any writer worth his or her salt, isn't it? Mm-hmm. The sheer playfulness may also be described as the ability to imagine oneself into a situation which is not necessarily connected to the life you lead whatsoever. Mm-hmm. To let the ball, let the ball bounce, and by itself. The deadly seriousness is another affliction, which has to be there. Things have to seem to you to matter a great deal. Mm. I think that the writer tends to have, spiritually if not outwardly, a moral stake in everything. And this can be the timidest person who's, once he or she leaves the desk, is absolutely terrified by everything, doesn't go into the world. Emily Dickinson would be a good example, right? It doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. It's at the moment the person is being a writer, should be a tiger of some kind.
Roth again showed his mettle in 1998 with I Married a Communist, which tells the story of Nathan Zuckerman's boyhood hero, Ira Ringgold, a 1940s radio star. Ira's life is destroyed when his ex-wife betrays him by publishing an account of their marriage that denounces him as a communist and as a Soviet spy. The novel is an eloquent portrayal of an era when America is on the brink of paranoia and the McCarthy years.
What is your feeling about the place of ideology in this novel? What do you want to get at and war with?
I'd have to go back and connect this novel to the one before. When I finished that book, I was in the mood and in the mode, and I'd liked doing it, and it seemed to me to have freed up something that had never been freed up in my work before.
Namely, what?
The joining of the public and the private, the seeing the private drama as a public drama, really, or put another way, so saturated by history, the private drama, that it's determined by the history. That's very much what happens in I Married a Communist. And so I asked myself, well, what else do you know? What other period do you know? It was no accident, as you Marxists say, that I began with the Vietnam War, because that was the most dramatic decade of my adult life and will probably be so unless things change in the next few weeks. But when I looked for what was the next most dramatic moment, obviously, clearly, it was the anti-communist hysteria of the post-war years, which I also knew something about because of a family history. My family, especially my father's family, which was the dominant family, consisted of a lot of brothers, who all of whom had allegiances on the left, beginning, say, with left of center, which was the Roosevelt New Deal policies, which my father was very firmly, and then a series of cousins and brothers who occupy the spectrum all the way down to the communists, the communist cousin, the communist uncle.
And it meant what for them to be a communist at that time? What did that...
meant a lot. My cousins were young guys. They were older than I was. They were stuck in the Depression. They weren't the only young guys in America who were anti-capitalist and communist. That marked that generation. Especially these guys were guys with high school educations. Nobody went to college in my family till I did, I think. Mm-hmm. So what I'm getting at is the talk was kind of talk you hear in a house where that's the education level. Doesn't mean it's stupid talk, but it means it's very direct, I think. And then there were arguments. Don't listen to your aunt. Don't listen to your cousin. That goddamn communist, you know. So, of course, terrifically exciting for a kid.
But the theme of betrayal hadn't snuck its way in yet. This is still a period when...
No, I didn't even know what betrayal meant. And then the school.
And then
I was never indoctrinated, Senator, in any class I went to by anyone, but the kind of flavor of openness, of experiment, of teaching enthusiasm. I got the good of it. Mm-hmm. There was one of my old high school teachers who is still alive. He's 92, and he's someone I speak. He's a pal, really. He's in terrific mental shape. He says to me, when I said you guys were great teachers, he said, it wasn't for you kids, we couldn't have done it.
And what of the communist tone of Ira Ringgold? Ira Ringgold seems a sympathetic ideologue in that way.
Well, sympathetic to you because he's impure. Sympathetic to me, too. Mm-hmm. Ira's tragedy is he's not a pure revolutionary. He does 500 things. He's a bourgeois at home, and he's a revolutionary at the Union, et cetera, et cetera.
And he's a husband of a particular wife. He marries a woman named Eva Frame, who's a big silent film star. In order to save her own career, she gives away her husband on a platter.
Yeah.
Is that what McCarthyism was writ small?
For my purposes, what interested me as the book began to unscroll itself was the place of betrayal. Not necessarily the negative aspects of betrayal, but the very human thing that betrayal is. And indeed the educational tool it is. That is, to go from A to Z, you got to betray B, at least in my book. So I hope the book isn't moral. lying about betrayal. That's a mug's game, isn't it? Mm-hmm. I'm against betrayal? Mm-hmm. Terrific. Good, huh? That Roth's a square shooter. It pervades the book. So betrayal, I think, is seen in this book as the human stuff.
When before had betrayal ever been so destigmatized and rewarded in this country? It was everywhere during those years, the accessible transgression, the permissible transgression that any American could commit. Not only does the pleasure of betrayal replace the prohibition, but you transgress without giving up your moral authority. You retain your purity at the same time as you are patriotically betraying, at the same time as you are realizing a satisfaction that verges on the sexual with its ambiguous components of pleasure and weakness, of aggression and shame. The satisfaction of undermining, undermining sweethearts, undermining rivals, undermining friends.
Philip, there's a moment in I Married a Communist when poor Nathan Zuckerman has written a pathetic ideological radio play, and he presents it to his revered literature professor, a man named Glucksman. And Glucksman does everything but throw it back in his face and just pronounces it ideological shit. At this point, Glucksman talks about writing and writing well as mm-hmm. the only political act that a mm-hmm. writer can make. Do you believe that to be the case?
Oh, this is such a big subject. But he says it in a moment in a context where it's earned by me, I think. It isn't me suddenly standing up and saying something. What Glucksman is saying to Zuckerman is, get rid of that rhetoric, it stinks. I'll give you some new rhetoric.
Does our man learn from it sufficiently, Zuckerman?
No, because he's immediately goes down to visit Johnny O'Day, the steel worker in Indiana there, where all the steel mills are. And he's won over by not just the rhetoric of this powerful communist, but the steel mills themselves. Look, one of the things this book is about is this boy trying to learn what kind of man he wants to be.
Right.
Does he want to be his father's son? Does he want to be Leo Glucksman's son? Does he want to be Ira Ringgold's son? What he goes through fathers chronologically, sequentially, until he says you're out there in this thing all alone, which is manhood.
Roth tackled more recent American history in the third novel of his trilogy, The Human Stain. Against the backdrop of the hysteria surrounding President Clinton's relationship with Monica Lewinsky, the book tells the story of a classics professor, Coleman Silk, whose career is destroyed following a student's false accusation of racism. The charge is doubly ironic because Silk himself has a secret. For over 40 years, he has been passing as white, in denial of his African-American origins. Cast out of his academic community, Silk begins a controversial relationship with Fawnia Farley, a seemingly illiterate janitor, 35 years his junior.
We come to another novel that will end with a ruined man again. Philip, we met just a few years ago, 1998, and you came to my office at The New Yorker. This was the summer of Bill Clinton's humiliation.
Mm-hmm. 98.
And you said, maybe I ought to invite some writers to write short pieces about what was going on. One of the writers who said no was Philip Roth. And the reason, obviously, was that you were at work on The Human Stain. Now, you began that novel simultaneous with the beginning of this mortification of Bill Clinton. How did that start?
I met President Clinton that summer. He'd been through the worst of his humiliation. That 10-hour inquisition on television. And because I know I met him after that, and he... Talk about an assailable man, which is more or less the subject of these three books, the assailability of these men who seem so strong, not the assailability of people who are at the bottom, but Swede LaVove and Ira Ringgold and later Coleman Silk and Bill Clinton. They'd been smashed And he looked like somebody who had been smashed. He looked unhealthy. Mm-hmm. All that vigor that you see, all that spontaneous vigor. He'd imagine what the humiliation. Forget the terrible crime he committed, you know? my heart goes out even to Raskolnikov, you know, because Dostoevsky makes me feel that. And Bill Clinton didn't kill two old ladies. He had a kind of sex with one young lady, nonetheless. The public humiliation had been extraordinary. The public humiliation of Ira Ringgold and the public humiliation of Coleman Silker are central to the destruction of those two men.
It was the summer in America when the nausea returned, when the joking didn't stop, when the speculation and the theorizing and the hyperbole didn't stop, when the moral obligation to explain to one's children about adult life was abrogated in favor of maintaining in them every illusion about adult life, when the smallness of people was simply crushing, when some kind of demon had been unleashed in the nation, and on both sides, people wondered, why are we so crazy? It was the summer when, for the billionth time, the jumble, the mayhem, the mess proved itself more subtle than this one's ideology and that one's morality. It was the summer when a president's penis was on everyone's mind, and life, in all its shameless impurity, once again confounded America.
At what point, though, Philip, did these books start to come in view as a trilogy? Midway through the second, beginning the third?
I would say that once I was nearing the end with I Married a Communist, number two, I was, as I said, deeply in the mood. And I thought, what else do you know? You know, what else do you know about a moment? I began these books, I guess I was 60, right? So I've been around for a long time. Mm. And I could see my own country historically. And so I thought, what else do you know? And I said, for God's sakes, it's right in front of you. Mm-hmm. It's right in front of your nose. And there it was, of course. And I thought, treat 98 as though it was 48. Treat 98 as though it were 68, you see? See it, if you can, as history.
The hero of that book, the center of that book, is Coleman Silk, who is a professor, interestingly enough, of classics, who knows mm-hmm. everything about tragedy, mm-hmm. except that which is
to
avoid one, and that which is about to be visited upon us. And he has a secret that we learn about in chapter two, and the secret is that he has embarked on an American project, which is to escape the great we, mm-hmm. to escape race. He is black. He's light-skinned, but he mm-hmm. comes from black parents. But he's light enough to pass.
Yeah, he wants to separate himself from the predicament into which he was born. Not the first person to want to do that. You needn't be black to want to do that. You needn't be Jewish to like Levy's rye bread, they used to say. Many people in America, particularly, have had the opportunity to abandon origins they didn't want to bother with, that they felt imprisoned by, that they felt compromised by, that they felt ashamed of, that they felt were encumbrances of one kind or another. And who is to say that people have no right to throw off skins if they can throw them off in pursuit of happiness, especially in a country where it was very possible to disappear. People disappear in America. So he has a background which is right in the American grain, Coleman Silk.
Beware the Ides of March. Bullshit. Beware nothing. Free. With both bulwarks gone, the big brother overseas and the father dead, he is repowered and free to be whatever he wants, free to pursue the hugest aim, the confidence right in his bones to be his particular I. free on a scale unimaginable to his father, as free as his father had been unfree. Free now, not only of his father, but of all that his father had ever had to endure. The impositions, the humiliations, the obstructions, the wound and the pain and the posturing and the shame, all the inward agonies of failure and defeat. Free instead on the big stage. Free to go ahead and be stupendous.
The incident early on in Human Stain that trips the wire is Coleman Silk is in his classroom, and a couple of kids are not showing up on a consistent basis, and he asks, are they real or are they spooks? Of course, it turns out that those guys are black, and he's accused of using a racial epithet. Spooks being the racial epithet. How did that come about?
Where did they get the idea from?
Yeah.
That's much too good an idea for me to have had spontaneously.
Probably,
is what you're
asking. Yeah.
And that's right. I heard about this thing because it happened to a friend of mine. It was a galling incident. It ended his career, a very distinguished academic career. But only when I realized it happened to Coleman Silk did the thing pack a punch, a real punch. And this, what I'm saying is I attached this character to that anecdote, David, to that, and then my book was combustible, you know.
You've got three women in the three novels who represent in one form or another a kind of ideological fanaticism, extremism. You have, and now in the third novel, you have the most heroic woman in this maybe most heroic figure and the most erotic woman here is Fonya. Where does she come out of?
I don't know where she comes from, really. The book raises questions, and you answer it. Sentence by sentence, really, phrase by phrase, then chapter by chapter, etc., then draft by draft. And when you've answered all the questions, the book is done. And one of the questions the book asks is, who is the woman? What is the character interested in? Well, she's interested in these birds. I have crows all over my place here. And I took a great interest in these crows. I thought, well, why can't she too be interested in crows? Fonya says, I am a crow. Once I can get her to say that legitimately, I've got an awful lot of backfilling to do, right? I can write.
Every figure in this novel tries to one degree or another to expunge themselves of the human stain. What is the human stain?
It just has to do with the inbuilt imperfection, doesn't it? That which is imperfect and indelible and with us. Fonny goes to visit the Audubon Society to see this crow who she's developed a personal attachment to. And when she's there, the person who runs the Audubon Society is telling Fonny that the crow doesn't know crow language. And that when one day the crow happened accidentally to get out into the trees, the other crows tried to kill it. She speaks of the human stain. She uses the phrase, and then I take off from it, and I help her along with it.
That's what comes of being hand-raised. That's what comes of hanging around all his life with people like us. The human stain. That's how it is. We leave a stain. We leave a trail. We leave our imprint. Impurity. Cruelty, abuse, error, excrement, semen. There's no other way to be here. Nothing to do with disobedience. Nothing to do with grace or salvation or redemption. It's in everyone. Indwelling, inherent, defining. The stain that is there before its mark.
Philip, in a way, the trilogy begins with Vietnam saturation and ends a little bit with it. One of the characters in Human Stain is Les Farley, a Vietnam vet, a completely shot through, ruined man. And he's the subject of the most incredible physical scene, I think maybe in all your books. The setting is so dramatic, and it comes at the very end, where he is ice fishing. Mm-hmm. If you describe that scene and how that works to end the trilogy.
Mm. At the end of the book, this is the man who's killed Coleman Silk and killed his Fawnia, who had been Les Farley's wife, in an automobile accident. He drives them off the road into the river. But he survives. And Zuckerman alone knows that probably that's how they died, and accidentally sees Les Farley's pickup truck out alongside a body of water up here. It's hidden back in the woods, and gets out and stupidly pursues Les Farley through several hundred yards of open field and woods to this beautiful oval of a lake hidden in the hills. And you've seen people ice fishing. It's a very odd thing to see. I guess if you ice fish, you don't think it's odd, but if you don't, you do. And there's a big lake, and on it, scattered very far apart, they don't like to be near each other, are these guys who fish in the ice with little short rods and their lures, et cetera, et cetera. And they drill a hole in the ice with an auger. They often walk away with nothing after 4 hours, but it's not why they're out there. They're out there to be way, way, away from something. And not so they can write books. So they can be angry, in the case of my guy, without killing somebody. So they can be dead while being alive. So they can be cold. I don't know what the hell they're all doing. But when I got to the end of this book, I liked the scene. I liked what it looked like. I liked that all that silver whiteness and no body but this one human marker. You know, it just seemed to me the way to end three books. I think at the end, Zuckerman says, that's the whole picture, if not the whole story. Mm-hmm. I like the picture. I like these two men locked together like the last two men on Earth. They're not the last two men on Earth. They're not even the last two men in New England, but it feels that way. And I just felt the... you feel something musical, really. You feel you have an ending.
You write, you live a certain way. Every day you engage them for I don't know how many hours a day while you're actually at the desk.
Mm-hmm.
It's the consuming activity of your life. What's it for? Who is it for?
Yeah. You might well ask. I don't know what else to do. I don't know what else to do. I don't know how else to do anything. I can't do anything else. So otherwise I just sit idly in this seat without the television stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what to do, David. I've been doing it all my life. If it were taken away from me, I think I would die, probably. And without being overly dramatic, I would be emptied.
Is there a sense of mastery at some point that you might not have had at 40?
There's patience.
What did age give you? What did experience give you?
Patience. That is the patience to outlast your frustration. The confidence that if you just stay with it, you'll master it,
mm-hmm.
You know? But that doesn't mean tomorrow necessarily. But that, I think it gives you confidence in your instincts and those spontaneous activities I spoke of earlier. You don't feel like such a gambler, such a risk taker in laying down the first 10 or 20 or 50 pages. So I guess age or experience give you patience, confidence. But the confidence can be shattered at the end of a first draft. Probably any work where you start with nothing on a page and you have to fill the page is accompanied by a lot of anxiety and a lot of fear. That fear is simply that you can't do it. And frustration as you're doing it, because what comes is very crude. But over the years, I think what you develop is a tolerance for your own crudeness and patience. Patience with your own crap, really. and a kind of belief in your crap, which is just stay with your crap and it'll get better if you just stay with it and come back every day and keep going. But it's a living. It's turned out to be, I make about as good living as a New York dermatologist. And the difference is that he's been making it for longer than I have.
Philip, you had the experience of going back and reading these three books this last week.
Mm-hmm.
Preparation just for our talk. Mm-hmm. What was it like to read your own books?
I haven't read these books in a while. I can't honestly say I was displeased by what I read. I saw my own method, you know?
How do you mean?
Well, I mean, I guess it's like watching the videos of the game where you had five for six at bats, you know? And you see your swing. I saw that what I'd staked everything on was density.
Density of?
Surface. Mm-hmm. I'll give you a painting analogy. Jackson Pollock's big paintings, which I think are marvelous and wonderful. Everything, it's covered. They're covered.
Mm-hmm.
And they're covered with energy. They're covered with pictorial substance, too, which is the paint. They're covered, as we know, with energy. They're completely covered. And it's dramatized in every square inch somehow. That's the amazing thing. As opposed to, say, Mark Rothko. Mm-hmm. It's also covered. But it's covered in a different way. And what I felt was a kind of affinity in these three books in terms of the compositional struggle and solution to those big Pollock paintings. That I tried to cover every square inch with real stuff. The other thing is, I wish I could know what this guy knows. I think I could make a life out of this.
Mm-hmm.
That is, there's a knowledge that the writing produces that is not your knowledge. It's produced by the demands of the narrative. And lo and behold, there's knowledge there.
Mm.
Or wisdom, even, of all things. But it's not yours.
As a reader rather than in a different way.
Well, I know I don't know these things.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I'm not trying to be cute or precious or whatever. It comes of the activity. So when Jackson Pollock isn't painting, he doesn't know anything but how to drink. When I'm not writing, I don't know anything either.
In the fields of the Lord stood Abel and Cain. Cain slew Abel beneath the black rain. At night he couldn't stand the guilt or the blame. So he gave it a name. So he gave it a name. So again.